the empire feeds off the republic, and the empire replicates those social relations within the republic too. I mean, not only do you want to destroy the middle class and resource self-development and autonomy in those countries, you want to do the same thing in your own country too. You want a workforce that's hungry. The hungrier I can get you to be, the less choices you have, the harder I can work you for less and less. I mean, things were getting out of hand in America. That's what Jimmy Carter was told that by the business council. These guys came to him and said, what are you doing? You know, the inequality of income has been shrinking and shrinking and shrinking. We are going to end up as a social democracy. Imagine, these guys knew the term. I mean, there's only about 500 Americans who know what social democracy is, or even use the term. But these guys knew it, what it was. They meant we're not going to end up like Denmark and Sweden and that sort of thing. This stuff is countries which themselves are getting hit and being rolled back now, aren't they? But you've got to stop this. So the empire, the costs of empire are borne also by the people of the metropolitan nation, of the home nation. Now there is a lot of literature saying that the empire is in decline. It's losing and all. I don't see that. I see new bases being built, monster bases all over. I see the republic going into decline. I see the republic being starved for this empire. I see $400 billion a year to the empire is now more like $800, $900 billion a year under Obama, with Bush helping and then Obama. Is that what you're talking about? I mean, that there is this interplay of need and resource between empire and republic.
Right, and also that there are elements within those countries that, in fact, end up winning by our intervention there. In our pawns, our peons, if you like, are the ones that help this intervention.
That's correct. In Indonesia, the rich Indonesians did very well with the American intervention that destroyed the Sukarno government and such. That's why the major unit of analysis is not nation state, it's class. Is what class is being served by whom? And that most definitely is something I should have included and made clear. I like when I said that the way the Germans went into Africa or the Italians went into Africa. I mean, it wasn't Germans and Italians. It was the ruling interests of these countries that went into plunder. I mean, my grandpa, he migrated to New York, to the United States. When I asked him why, he said, because I didn't want to die in Tripoli. That was the term he used. And I said, what do you mean, die in Tripoli? And he was saying the press gangs of the new Italian Republic. Now, this was 20 years before Mussolini, or about 14 years before. And they were taking these farm boys like him, farm workers, put them in the army to go kill people in Libya, in Tripoli. He says, I'm not going to go do that. So my grandpa was the draft dodger. That's a very honorable ancestry. And if he were here now, he would have liked to. Well, by now he probably would have gone to the bathroom. But anyway, I should make jokes. So it's not the people in now the common people get swept up in it because obviously no ruling class rules nakedly. It pumps up an ideology and. And the ordinary Cockney Brit will say, this is our empire, Britannia ruled the waves, and they sing the song as if they owned a piece of it instead of it was exploiting them, you know? That's called false consciousness. That's called when you're saluting the guys who are sticking it to you, you know?
Yeah.
And that's what they are doing right now. Yes, that gentleman then.
Okay, thank you. Do you speak in this book or have any theories about, like, the psychology participate in, you know, an empire and help to build it, while there's, you know, people, there's rooms full of people who's like this one all over the world who see it as inherently wrong?
Well, I wrote a book called Super Patriotism and talked about how they get caught up. some people, you know, learn a few equations and these things get hardwired in their brains very early. And one of them is to see love of country as a virtue. You see? Now, I see love of country as a virtue. Love of your community is always a nice thing, you know. But I said, loving what in my country? I had a lot of fun in Super Patriotism to play with that. I mean, what exactly, when we say America is number one, I said, number one in what? Population? No, the Chinese got us beat, the Indians got us beat. Real estate? No, Russia has us beat, even Canada's got us beat. Even China is almost as, I think, an actual... what are we number one in? Cuisine? No, I wouldn't even go there. I wouldn't even bother with that one. And it turns out we're number one in material force. That's what it is. Wealth and concentration of wealth and material force. And that's it. But that's not what they're taught. They're taught that this is the greatest country in the world. We have things we... A lot of those people aren't saying that as much now. You know, they just lost their mortgage, their house, and their job. And you don't see them waving the flag as fervently as they used to do it, you know. And I argued that, I didn't understand what loving your country means. I mean, what if I love the Piazza Ducale in Italy more than I love Rockefeller Center in New York? I bet everyone here would love the Piazza Ducale in Italy than Rockefeller Center. What a dump. And does that make me less of an American or what? Self-hating American? Or, I was asked, I get asked on the radio, when I'm getting on these radio programs in the real Yahoo areas sometimes back in the days in Vermont, I'd get on a station, guy would say, why do you hate your country? He said, do you love your country? I said, I love the people of all countries. You know,
yeah.
And of course I'm especially attached to my country. In fact, most of my research is about American politics and American history. And I am more better informed and immersed in that, of course. So these people, they get wired up that love my country, and then the love of the country, which is an empty kind of but powerful emotion. It's empty of content, really. That's what I was trying to do in that opening chapter. Super Patriotism is testing. What's the content of this? What exactly are you loving? You love all the American people? Come on, you hate this group, you hate that group, you hate the other group. Come on, give me a break. And then they connect that love with militarism. That militarism is a manifestation and proof of your love. Oh, he got both his legs blown off. He did this for his country, so that we could go on loving our country, loving our Chinese restaurants, you know, which are our American institution. That's not such a joke. This guy, do you remember the guy who had the pizza place right on the Mexican border, and he was willing to take Mexican pesos instead of dollars, and these guys got up in Congress and started screaming at him that this American food is being pirated, and they're using Mexican pesos instead of American dollars. It's an American dish. I said, wait a minute, pizza is an American dish? I happen to know otherwise, you know. So that's what I think. It's really a very intense feeling, and it's at a very low level of development, really.
What about the people way up in power who, like, make the call to go and kill, you know, all these people to steal their resources?
They love their fortunes. That's what they love. Thomas Jefferson said it. He said, the merchant loves the country on which he's standing waiting for the ships to return, you know, for the sails or something like that. Something like that. They so love America, they're taking all their investments off into other places offshore. I don't think they care about... They love their America. They love their country club. They love their kids' yacht club or whatever, this or that, the other thing. And I think it was that business council meeting. They said to him, Jimmy, you're going wrong. This is getting out of hand, they were saying. We got workers now, they want vacations. Now they don't want a week, they want 2 weeks. They want 3 weeks a year. Well, in Europe, they get 4 and 5 weeks, but they want 3 weeks vacation. They not only want vacation, they want paid vacation. Will it never stop? We'll end up in the poorhouse with these greedy workers just taking more and more. They want a minimum wage raise. They want this happening. They want that. There's no end to it. They want health benefits. Where the hell do they come from? Who the hell do they think? They don't want a population that's intelligent, that has a high sense of entitlement, that can organize itself. They want to cut back on your education. William Bennett, that reactionary, that guy who's always preaching to America about how to be virtuous, turned out he was a gambling addict himself, you know. And he said, too many people are going to college. I remember saying that a few years ago. I said, uh-oh. And sure enough, the way they're cutting back on loans, they're increasing tuition, they're making it harder and harder for people. They don't need you, they don't want you. That's not the model that they're really operating with. Now, they're not explicit about their model. They don't come out and say, we want a more depressed working force and a lower collective wage and the abolition of... They are saying that some of that about abolition of Medicare and Social Security and such. Or the president we have now is going to start cutting away at it. Who's a republic, as far as I know.
Deeper coming through history and partly through civilization.
Yeah. If you're looking at the force. You're looking at the forces of traditional thought and conformist socialization. Yeah, we could go on all night with that. By the way, I have discussions in here on the dominant paradigm. About that, the dominant paradigm in terms of the U.S. and imperialism, and how to get people to think about that differently.
Quartin or Bookchin relating to some of that, I think. Ecology of Freedom or The Turning by Quartin, perhaps. The Great Turning. Anyway, my other thing was, what do we do?
I know Mary Bookchin's work.
Yeah, he's good.
I know Mary Bookchin. Yeah, he's all right.
Well, what do we do? With resistance or protesting on the streets? I mean, what do we do, you know, other than informing people?
Yeah, resistance and protesting on the streets and ideological development.
Yes.
That's what we don't have.
Yes.
You got a Republican Party that for 40 years have been hitting it home, and they've got narratives. They've got ideological descriptions and explanations. You watch Fox, and every program there's fear injected into people. You're being oppressed by these elite, progressives and these people and us. There's a right wing populism that they have developed. They've won elections in places like Kansas, Oklahoma. They used to be populist. They used the populist idiom. And all those 40 years, the Democrats weren't doing a goddamn thing. Nothing. They still aren't doing anything. They're still just figuring out how they're going to win the election next year. Will you donate to me, please? And Obama's been disappointing and blah, blah. But there isn't. Well, these guys, they've given people simple answers. We've got to do this because of that. We've got to do this. And these people get it, take it. It's an internalization of this instant socialization. And then they repeat it. They just repeat that. I call it the parrot syndrome. They hear these things on TV and then they internalize them and repeat them like it's their own opinions. And then they get hardwired around them, and then it's hard to shake them. But there are other people who really are trying to figure it out. Every day, I'm not kidding, I don't mean to sound immodest, but every day my email or Facebook or something, I get messages from people who say, gee, you really opened my eyes. I was so confused. I was wondering why this was going this way and all that. And so I think it's very important work when people say, oh, just sitting around together and talking... It's not going to do it. Man, ideas count, words count. That's why I was using these words and trying to tell you what were the forces behind those words. All of that really counts. It's not that the activism, save the whales, save this community here, stop fracking. It's true. They can create evils faster than we can even send out a mailing to start identifying these evils, and that's what they're doing. So, well, we need that activism. I don't want to put anybody down who's involved in activism. You are the salt of the earth. But we also need to pause every so often and say, but why are they doing this? Who is doing this? Is it just this company? How could they possibly do this to people? What are the set of values? What are the implicit ideologies behind what they're doing? And what's our ideology? What's our goal? How do we want the resources of this society to be used? What do we want the U.S. federal budget to look like?
Yeah.
And that sort of thing, you see. Yes, Abby.
I was just going to say that, you know, services and the upward transfer of wealth is just an inherent system of capitalism. It is inherent within the system that we're living in.
For those of you back in the cheap seats, she said that it's inherent in the nature of capitalism that you're going to see this kind of misdistribution and this upward distribution and this continual accumulation at the top and deprivation at the bottom. Is that what you're saying? Yeah, but, you know, that's one of the arguing points we should point out, that capitalism doesn't work for the most part. I wouldn't say for restaurants. Restaurants, I think they should be self-owned. That's okay. But aside from restaurants and maybe three or four other things, capitalism doesn't work. You really want to ride on trains that are run for the purpose of maximizing profits for the stockholders and the owners? That's what we get with Amtrak. And then it gets bailed out by socialism. And then the trains are running again and new cars are brought in and it's going better and all that. And then the stock is floated again on the market. It goes public again and people start buying it up. They make money on it. And it's back again. It gets milked and stripped. And that's the way it is. We should point out that I'm for socialism because it works. I used to tell this to students at the State University. They said, socialism, how would that work? I don't know if I want to be in that. I said, you're already in that. You're at a state university. That's a socialist institution. Boom, boom, boom. What? Off-camera music. Boom, boom, boom. And you can see the panic in their eyes as they look for the door to run out. And all that. I say, stay. It's not that bad, you see. I say, the faculty here is just as good as the faculty, in fact, better than some of the private schools. The students are better, in fact. You're learning, you see. It works. Socialism works. I had a socialist institution that I loved when I was a kid. Loved is too strong a word, but I liked it a lot. That was the public library. I didn't know in those days that it was a socialist institution. It was nobody made a profit. No money was ever exchanged by anybody. Any poor person could go in and get a card, and then you could read any of the books that you wanted to read, you know? And here I was living in a very poor neighborhood, and you know, when I got tired, when I would get tired of the pool room and the handball court and the street, I would go to the library and I would have a refuge there. Not because I was so given to ideas and intellectuality at 14, no, 15, but I was hungry to get a window, get a look into other worlds and other experiences that were beyond the confines of my present life. And it was a great refuge. Now I hear that Oakland is closing down. Of its 18 library branches, it's closing 14 of them. What is that going to do? Well, there's some kids who are really going to feel that. What do they got left except to go sit in front of the idiot television set still longer? So there's a case of socialism working. The libraries. There's a case. Public education. That, for all its faults and all, it was better. It's better. There are communities that are fighting to get rid of their charter schools and get back to public education. What is a charter school? It's a school that privatizes all the work situations, lowers their wages, and makes sure there's a profit for the guy who is in the company that runs it, like a private prison and such. These are all, they're privatizing the military, all these special mercenary units. Instead of paying them $400 a week to kill people, they're giving them like $1,000 a day to go out and kill people. So socialism works better than capitalism. We try to use a counter-narrative. Part of the problem is we have limited resources. We don't own Fox. We don't have a television network. We don't have millions of people who we can reach. I get a book published, but it's in a small, even that, it's in a small publishing house. It's not, when Bill O'Reilly gets a book published, it gets a print of 200,000 copies, you know, and half of them are bought up by this group or that group to get his book on the bestseller list in the second week or something. So even on those levels, we're outgunned and all that. And yet, I would just say, well, you just don't give up. You just keep trying to do these things. You go in demonstrations, yep. You sign letters, you make phone calls, mm-hmm. You join organizations, you raise criticisms about these things, and that's the best you can do. You know, despite all their advantages, it's amazing. Sometimes the polls are quite amazing. Right now, 67% of the American people say we want more attention paid to the social wage. They don't use that term. That's an old socialist term. But more paid to social welfare, to what's the term?
Living wage.
No, it's not a wage. It's not a wage. Human services. We want more, better human services. We want better things. That we want this mortgage scandal to be cleaned up so people can get their houses back. That's what they're talking about. They're not talking about, let's go kill some more Shiite or Sunni rebels or something. That's not what they're involved with. That's what our friends in the White House and the CIA are involved with. Well, let's go kill Gaddafi and all. You see people dancing in the streets in America because Gaddafi's been taken down, if he has been taken down. I don't see it. I think the right-wing Republicans are so intelligent. They're politically so smart. They know that they represent the interests of about 1% of the population, but they've got to hide that. They've got to. I heard Buckley and a few of his friends one time on a Sunday afternoon TV talk show about how we have to cultivate more interest in cultural issues to deflect the working class away. They forgot they were on public television, I guess. I don't know, but they were saying to deflect the working class away from from making pocketbook demands and that sort of thing, and get them, in other words, get them involved with what's the color of the skin of my neighbor going to be, rather than is he and I both going to be able to earn a decent living in the factory that we work in, you know. So play on racism, which has always been used, play on homophobia, you know. I mean, that same-sex marriage, that was throwing red meat at them. They were just probably had cheers of gratitude. Thank you so much. Now, yet another thing to distract voting constituencies for so long. I'm not putting it down. The right to marriage is a human right and should belong to everybody and anybody. And as Will Durst said, remember, he said, you don't want homosexuals to have sex with each other. You think it's horrible and disgusting. Well, what better way to keep them having sex than let them get married, you know? They organized. They developed conservative activists. They got these kids into the best law schools. They farmed them out and put them into clerking in the top law firms and courts. Before you know it, they were being appointed as federal judges at the appeals level and district level, and they consciously, when Ronald Reagan started appointing judges, no Democrat had ever done this, ever thought of it. Ronald Reagan took young judge when he appointed these judges, and he had about 700 appointees. He took guys who were in their 30s and 40s and appointed them, not in their 60s who would last 7 years, 8 years, 10 years. He put in guys who were going to be in there for the next 30, 40 years. We got one like Clarence Thomas. He's still with us, and he's going to be going on for another 20 years. And they know to do that. Even the color that identifies their party, for Christ's sake. The Republican Party was always the blue party when I was a kid. When Dwight Eisenhower beat Adlai Stevenson, you saw the map, all blue except for it was still a Democratic South, and that was in this pinkish red. And I remember that distinctly. The Republican Party was blue. The Democratic Party had red. And then the Republicans read some studies that said red was a more inciting and more commanding color than blue. They switched. And they got their party to be blue. So now we talk about the blue. There wasn't a single thing that they've left uncovered and such. Like, as I said, the age of judges that they appoint. And they appoint ideological right-wing judges to these positions. Not a guy who's like going to be an Earl Warren and turn around and have some liberal things, you know. So they know what the hell they're doing. That's my answer to your question. They know what they're doing. They had an agenda. They had the long march through the institutions. We talked about that. That was a Maoist phrase, a long march to power. The long march was, you know, part of the Chinese Revolution. And so we have to have a long march in the institutions. Well, they really did it. They really did it. And also part of it is that they have the resources to do it, whereas the Democrats don't have that money, don't have access to the media. Dennis Kucinich doesn't get that kind of coverage, you know. But Michelle Bachmann does get that kind of coverage. That darling, I love her. She's so nice. Yes, sir. They didn't mean quite what we mean today about it, though, I think.
We're going to Louisiana Purchase.
I wonder, is this what we're seeing is more or less almost an inevitable natural progression of what it is that we started with altogether, or is this sort of thing that's been going on here the last 50, 60 years, kind of an aberration that's kind of a growth like a cancer?
What thing?
This push that ever further and further into this empire building.
Well, Washington and Jefferson were thinking of empire in terms of territoriality, of having more resources, more expansion for population and for strength. And it was called manifest destiny, that we, sooner or later, were going to reach the Pacific coast. And all it needed was a small little war in 1848 where we took more than 50% of Mexico. In fact, we're standing in it right now. This used to be Mexico. And we want English language, don't we? Only English language. San Pablo, Santa Cruz, San Francisco, Los Angeles, all English language. Yeah, you know. So that's different. The empire today is global. The territory, when an empire expands and gets a presence in an area, that makes that area now has to be defended, like any asset. It becomes an asset. And that means then that on the boundary of that area are new enemies that you have to watch for. So as the U.S. moves into Central Asia in a way they never dreamed that they would ever be able to do back in 1990, just 20 years ago, when the U.S. moves into Central Asia, they then have to defend Kyrgyzstan. They then have to defend in Afghanistan or try to maintain their foothold or presence. For all the reasons that I just said, I'm not going to go through the whole talk again about resources and a particular kind of social order and all that sort of thing. But that leaves extended strength and power, but also extended vulnerability and extended stress. And the people back home, eventually, you've got to wonder now, when are they going to say, well, you know, one war, two wars are okay, three wars, four, well, now you're bombing six countries. Maybe this is a little too much, you know. And that's when the liberals come in and said, we're overextending. You know, they're not overextending. They didn't do this because they're stupid or because they're, I don't want to repeat my whole talk, but because of the imperatives and the dynamics of it. So the perimeter, the patricians will bleed the center in order to expand and strengthen the perimeter. And the perimeter doesn't have a distinct territoriality anymore the way Manifest Destiny had. It could be, you know, today the Arctic, tomorrow South Africa, the next day Micronesia, who knows.
Okay.